good enough touch to put it away.
Three for that. Good running. Yeah, nice sliding of the bat. He's got in for four. That's good. Real good cricket from these two young players. Light off at the batsman. They've taken it. It is fairly dark here now. The players went off then with the total at 109 for four, and they tried several times to come back on, but either bad light or rain stopped them. 109 for four. And the not-out batsman, Thorpe, was in good form for his 37. Ramprakash unbeaten on 12. That is a very handy little partnership there for England, and they need much more of it. The bowling figures for West Indies, I thought they were terrific today. Ambrose, 11.1 overs, 4 maidens, and 1 for 24. Walsh bowled fast, 1 for 33 and 11. Bishop bowled well, 1 for 30, 1 from 6. And Kenny Benjamin, although he's suffering from an injury, 6 overs, 1 maiden, and 1 for 19. So after 3 days in this match, it's been intensely interesting cricket. It's not over yet. England still in there with a chance, but they do need a lot of runs in the second innings. 199 and 109 for four. West Indies 282. England 26 runs ahead and 6 wickets in hand at the moment. Yesterday, Mike Atherton successfully motivated his bowlers to change tactics as they managed to keep the West Indies lead to only 83 runs. Now he needs the same motivation from his remaining batsmen after three of his more experienced men assisted in their own dismissals. Well, nothing in that little lot to please the skipper, Michael Atherton. He certainly will be hoping for better things today. The game was delayed for 1 hour. The umpires managed to get it away at midday. We can play on till 7 o'clock. So that's the good news of the day. Other good news now coming in the pitch report from Geoffrey Boycott.
Fourth day of this Leeds Test match, and the pitch hasn't changed much. It's pretty dry. You can see the footholds here. They're pretty dry. The covers have done the job. Very dry indeed. No rain on the pitch. We walk down, lovely grass covering everywhere. Nice and even. This is a length. Further down, short of a length, it's still the same. They've wanted extra pace in the Headingley pitch, and they've got it. They've wanted more bounce in a Headingley pitch. They've got that too. So nobody should complain about this. There's no cracks in it. There's always going to be a bit in it for the bowlers at Headingley because the atmosphere's cool, overcast. It's that type of cricket ground. But all in all, it's a good cricket pitch. Neither side could complain about this. And with the shot some of the England batsmen played, they certainly can't complain that it was the pitch that got them out. I'm looking forward to today.
And everyone is, particularly England's fans, if they can get away to a decent start. They're beginning at 109 for four. The not-out batsman, Graham Thorpe, on 37. He played very well yesterday. So too did Mark Ramprakash, unbeaten on 12. Now, the bowling figures for West Indies, I was most impressed with the way they went about their job yesterday. Ambrose, 11.1 overs, 4 maidens, and 1 for 24, is just about back to his best. Walsh 1 for 33, Bishop 1 for 31. They've all pitched in there, and Benjamin 1 for 19. And the situation of the game as we start this fourth morning, 1 hour late. England 199, West Indies 282, and England in their second innings 109 for 4 and a 26-run lead at the moment. We join it with the third ball of the third over. Curtly Ambrose is the bowler. Graham Thorpe is taking strike, and one run has been added to the overnight score.
Shot. He's just in that situation like a batsman, a talented batsman who's not getting runs, things not going for him. Nice leg glance. Well, we've seen England batsmen get out to this type of ball. Short, they're all going after it, and suddenly it climbs on Ram Prakash and he's nowhere near it.
Good stretch. It'll feel to be a little slow after the heavy overnight rain. The Ambrose fielder, easy three. Very good save by Junior Murray. Where did that come from?
Nice bowling.
Oh, a bowls. Beautiful delivery. Almost unplayable from Courtney Walsh. That's what West Indies have been waiting for this morning. Absolutely on line and just held its line onto the off stump.
Well, for once, Mark, Ram Prakash could not be blamed from the way he was out. That was a perfect ball by Courtney Walsh. Just speared in just about middle and off and then straightened out, as they say, a little bit of leg cut, hitting the outside edge of the off stump. There was nothing Mark Ram Prakash could have done with that ball.
Ram Prakash is gone for 18. And Philip de Freitas, one of those semi-all-rounders, is at the crease. That's down. That was a very sharp chance. Jimmy Adams is actually relatively deep at short leg. Noted for some great reflexes, and that would have been a fantastic catch had it stuck.
The amazing thing about this is Courtney Walsh's reaction afterwards. Jimmy Adams has taken quite a few catches at that position for the West Indies in the last series against Australia.
Fine shot. That definitely falls into the category of dismissive. And 50, a very hard-earned and very good 50 for Graham Thorpe. Rightfully acknowledging the applause of both his teammates and the Headingley crowd here on this Sunday, fourth day of this first test match. It's a lovely way to reach the mark of 50. He's played it again, that's in the air, Jimmy Adams is down there. But Graham Thorpe gets away with it. Wasn't quite in control of that particular shot. With Jimmy Adams lurking 70 yards away at deep square leg, there was an element of danger. That's lofted very high in the air. Chanderpaul is underneath it at mid-on. Very comfortable catch indeed for him. Not a particularly clever shot by any stretch of the imagination. The leading edge of his consulate, Philip de Freitas, does no more than trudge his way from the field. He's out for one. Darren Goff still receiving the expected warm welcome in his home territory. This is why he's having to walk out there. Philip de Freitas doing nothing more than playing across the line, just a fraction early. The leading edge sends it up into a nice grey sky. It's a lot easier to judge these sort of catches from a cloudy sky than it is from a bright blue sky. And Chanderpaul gets himself in the ideal position, hands together before the ball's arrived. Nice and high too, so above the eye line and in she goes. Well bowls, just managed to get it down in front of the slips. And a run for Darren Goff. Indeed, two runs for Darren Goff. He avoids the ignominy of a pair on his home ground.
very good square of the wicket. A good play of the pull shot, Graham Thorpe. He showed that in Australia and against New Zealand and more against South Africa last year. Well, he's a good cricketer.
A good control pull is this, Richie, isn't it? He's played so well all day. He's looked a good player.
That has got him with a devilish delivery. And Walsh has produced another absolute blinder there. He got Ram Prakash with a beauty. And now he's dismissed Graham Thorpe, a man who's completely set and playing wonderfully well. And he's produced it's an unplayable delivery because Thorpe did play it. But it was a very, very good ball to produce for a man who's made 61. Good knock from Thorpe. Very impressive.
Well, I just mentioned how well he has played. He's really looked a test match player.
Peter Martin is the new batsman. Short of the man at backward square.
Well, that's why they brought up the leg gully, because Peter Martin gets a short ball into the ribs and he really fends it off with the bat, but he never really looks at the ball. The head goes away, he's not looking at it, and it's really a slice of luck that he doesn't carry to the leg gully.
Keith Atherton. It's one of Darren Goff's usual strokes, a real wind-up, and off the meat of the bat.
Yes, he hit it pretty well. It was in the air, and just a half a chance there for Keith Atherton. Yep, through his hands.
To be quick here. Bird is down, field has stayed on his feet. Nothing worse than falling on your portable telephone. You can do yourself a terrible injury.
He's probably using crepes, is Dickie, and then with the grass being a bit wet, a slippery, damp. Oh, the fielder ran into him, knocked him over.
This is what happened. Martin says no. Goff is trying to get back. And down goes Harold Bird. That is the sort of thing, catching you off balance like that, can be quite dangerous. Bird is in so much pain he virtually only signaled a three.
Well, it's a good hit from Peter Martin, but he's on the back foot. Everything's been short. The batsman knows it's coming. If the batsman knows what length the bowler's bowling all the time, it's much easier to hit the ball.
But it's quite safe. Two more runs to Martin. Well, that's nicely played. Beautifully played, lovely flourish. Always a touch of the cavalier about Darren Goff.
that's well played by Goff. He was forward immediately and the ball was speared into his pad. And as soon as it was pitched just about the pad, he decided he's going to flick it around and four runs.
So 100 lead has been achieved. 101 runs, England are ahead. Cracking shot. It's almost as if he's seen these strokes in the picture book. And they're just copying them. But he's done it before. He's infuriated fast bowlers and slow bowlers. Terrific shot. That's gone in the air. It's gone many a mile. It's four. Down to the old pavilion. Firm clip of the bat.
Well, certainly not the shot of a tail ender here. Martin taking up the challenge. Ambrose bowling a little bit too short and just coming into the arc. Martin just helping it on its way to backward square leg.
That's out. The entertainment comes to an end. A miscue drive straight at the man at cover. It's the substitute fielder, Stuart Williams.
Well, I don't think it was the way West Indies anticipated getting him out, caught at cover. But it was a well-pitched-up ball. No reflection on Darren Goff, 29 very valuable runs. He plays in an aggressive way, blocks a few, plays his own shots, and that's good for late order batsmen or their specialist skill is bowling. People like Philip De Freitas and Darren Goff have to play a few shots.
Richard Illingworth, England's number 10. Comfortably caught by Brian Lara. Finally, Ian Bishop gets it just in the right place. England are nine down. That really was a nice, gentle chance as far as slips fielders are concerned.
Yes, he's tried for so long to pitch it. If he gets one, he gets the batsman forward. I'm sure Lara got it quite in his hands, but it was an easy enough catch. Coming forward, leaves him. And Lara, well, there's a nice height to catch, and as David says, you can't wish for many more gentler first slip catches than that.
Well, there's only one man left, Devon Malcolm. He's hit it. It was short, he's hit it well. Probably just too well from that point of view. He's got four runs for it. And that was an authentic pull shot, nicely executed. And the four runs at this stage potentially of less importance than the fact that England's innings could be all over if they can get the ball on target at Devon Malcolm. Scuffling back for two. So England passed the 200, 201 for nine. Something at least for the crowd to applaud. Well, he's struck it very firmly. Full swing of the bat. This, as far as Kirtley Ambrose is concerned, is the infuriating thing about Devon Malcolm. Every now and again, you get this.
Well, one of the few balls that Kirtley Ambrose has pitched up, and Devon's hit it sweetly right out of the middle of the bat.
giving himself room to the leg side. And crack.
That's all over. That's the end of the story as far as England's batting is concerned in this first Test match. One sweet blow followed by a rearrangement of all three stumps. Kirtley Ambrose has his third wicket of the innings. Right up there. That's actually quite a good delivery. Just a little bit of movement away from Devon Malcolm. Not as much movement as Devon Malcolm gave himself to move away. But England are all out for 208.
England 208, and there'll be no great amount of satisfaction there for Michael Abbott and his men. 29 for Darren Goff and Peter Martin, 19, Richard Dillingworth, 10. All valuable runs, but they really needed something between 150 and 200. Now, the bowling figures for the West Indies, an outstanding performance from Courtney Walsh. I thought he bowled really well. Bishop did well again. Benjamin's been off the field, so they really only had three bowlers, and from that point of view, it was an even better performance. Ambrose, 3 for 44 from 20.2 overs and 6 maidens. Now, the state of the match as West Indies began the fourth innings of the game. England 199 and 208 all out. West Indies 282, and they need 126 runs to win. We join play now with the third ball of the first over. It's Peter Martin bowling and Carl Hooper taking strike. There's a good start for Carl Hooper. That's got away from the pair. A lovely stroke off the back foot through the covers. Four for no wicket, West Indies. They need 126 in all. And De Freitas to Carl Hooper. It's a good shot. First one De Freitas really has got up to allow the ball to swing, and it didn't move one millimetre. Chipped off the middle of the bat.
This is the thing with Carl Hooper, he makes it look so easy. That was not really a full-blooded drive, more or less something of a push, and it's better with two mid off for four.
Great sight of the area around Headingley. This ground, which looks a picture. Great anticipation apart from anything else. The ball flew from a thick edge and it was on its way down. And the fielder hurled himself with marvellous anticipation away to his right. Nice way for the skipper to start.
Well, the Lancashire connection doing quite well here. Martin moving the ball away from Campbell, a perfect length, he had to play it. And Mike Addison making quite an acrobatic effort and taking it just inches above the ground.
Brian Lara's had a bit more opportunity to get himself clad and organised for the fray. In the first innings, it was the first baller for Carl Hooper. Good stroke, got a leg slip in there. He turned it and it didn't go at catching height. No ball called, didn't knock the bail off anyway. There must be hard glue, these Headingley bails. It happened an earlier occasion in the match. Gone back onto the stumps and quite firmly.
But clearly a no ball. And Carl Hooper, for a little bit, must have thought, well, things are not going for him, but they are. And Brian Lara, after 26 test matches, has an average of 55.76. quite high.
Good running. Nice piece of fielding from Devon Malcolm. And Vicky Bird deciding that it was good enough to merit a second look. This time the second look will come from the third umpire. Devon Malcolm down at long leg, one-handed up, and there she goes. Does have a very good arm, and nicely taken here. Beautifully taken by Alex Stewart. And I don't think Peter Willey will be dwelling on that for too long. That's savage. Beautifully placed. Anything just fractionally wide. And Brian Lara is very quickly into that shot. What a shot that is. That has just been eased miles over long off. A very simple looking shot, but very hard to execute. And Carl Hooper just shrugs his shoulders. Well, he's chipped that one straight again. Not quite the same sort of shot as before. 10 in two balls. Carl Hooper has this lovely ability to make life as a batsman look so easy. When he plays shots like this, just chipping the ball this time without the same power and force, but placing it perfectly. Target is now 84.
Much more orthodox shot, I think, from Carl Hooper. The short, maybe not too wide outside of the off stump, but he's quickly onto the back foot and spanked that one through extra cover for four.
Four more, savagely pulled away. This has been a wonderful over for Carl Hooper, not so wonderful for Philip DeFreitas. And it's also kept the umpire in heartwarming movement, and those West Indies fans loving every moment. Fetch that back. Doesn't seem to matter to Carl Hooper. That one's carried as well. Pure timing, taking it straight down the ground for six. Carl Hooper's in that sort of mood now where he doesn't mind really, it would seem, who bowls at him. Response is still going to be dramatic. Now that's six more, it must be. That's a higher, longer blow. Tossed up by Richard Inningworth and dispatched summarily by Carl Hooper.
Inningworth pitching it up on Carl Hooper, the first one just stepping out and hitting it effortlessly back over his head, and that was just short of the board there. And then the second one perhaps hit a little bit harder, a little bit higher actually. Hooper not moving as much. Six more.
Up, over and four. Peter Martin really must realise by now that he has to get the ball dead straight. If you give Brian Lara that space, that's all he wants. Well, there's no third man. England gambling on having the slips up in case of the chance coming from the edge, but the edge just ain't there. And Brian Lara just guiding the ball into the gaps. It's timing, it's placement. That's all he needs to do. And that's just so easily chipped away. Carl Hooper really in imperious form here today. And he's found the gap again. And that takes him to a very rapid 50. 50 not out. And he's faced just 45 balls. 7 boundaries, 7 fours that is, plus 3 sixes. It's been wonderful to watch. Devon Malcolm never saw it. He's about, I'm back into pick today, he was about 20 yards, 15 yards or so away from the ball at long leg, and the pull, well, it should have been picked up by Devon Malcolm. He was actually going in the opposite direction. Beautifully hit. 1-2 bounces down into the fence, wide of deep mid-wicket. Could well be 6, yes, into the Old Pavilion. Srinivas Venkatragovan signals 6. Carl Hooper plunders yet another one.
Martin around the wicket, but still short. This is all a learning curve, but he's hardly bowled a ball up in the right spot, on the right spot, since the time he took the wicket of Campbell with that beautiful delivery.
Just can't hold back when the spinner tosses it up. It was the same first innings. Trying to finish the game probably with a 6 and get his half century as well.
He's looking for it. Hasn't got it quite high enough. He's hit a 4 but not a 6. So he's just too short of the half century. Victory, and a very good victory too, to the West Indies by 9 wickets.
That was an outstanding performance from the West Indians. Hooper 73 not out and Lara 48 not out. Unlucky to miss his half century, played very well, but Hooper was quite outstanding, absolutely brilliant with his stroke play there. 129 for 1, and the bowling figures suffered accordingly. Martin couldn't pitch it up, he was coming up the hill there and couldn't counter that problem. 8 overs, 2 maidens, 1 for 49. De Freitas had 33 taken from 4. Illingworth 31 from 3. And Devon Malcolm was easily the best of the England bowlers. 4 overs, no maiden, none for 12. And bowled with plenty of pace and fire as well. So the match here, the first test match, sponsored by Cornhill, England against West Indies, a 6 test match series. England 199 having been put into bat by West Indies. That move was justified. 208 in the second innings. West Indies 282 all out. And 129 for 1. West Indies won by 9 wickets. And Ian Bishop was the man of the match. Terrific performance from him. Coming back from back injury, no one knew if he was even able to get through the match. Not only did he do that, but took out the award for the man of the match. Well, we have 3 men now, 2 of whom will not be quite as happy as the third. The third is the West Indian skipper, Richie Richardson. David Gower talked with him. He talked with Michael Atherton and Raymond Illingworth. First, the 2 captains.
Richie, congratulations. First test match done in this country. First test match victory, the perfect start for the series.
Yeah, thanks very much. I'm very pleased. It's always nice to start a tour, you know, on a winning note. Obviously, test matches are very, very important. We've got 5 more left, and this wind will boost our confidence quite a lot, and we're looking forward to have a very successful time.
You seem to be very relaxed in the preparation, although things hadn't gone your way in the Texaco Trophy matches, nor in many of the county matches as you would have hoped. You seem to be very confident before the test match started that it would all be right on the day.
Well, that's our nature. We're always cool. We tend not to worry too much. You know, we take things as they come. I mean, we even though we lost the one in the series, we know that test matches are different, and we would do a lot better in test matches. And I'm just hoping that we can continue to play as well as we have played in this match and if possible improve.
Well, congratulations. A very good win. If I can turn to your opposite number, Mike Allerton. Mike, in contrast, not the start you'd have wanted.
No, first test match for series is always an important time, and you want to play well and set the tone for the series, and we didn't do that.
But the plans you would have made beforehand would have been, you know, the team meeting before the game would have had a very different scenario. Having made those plans, which we assume were the right ones, pick the team, pick Alex Stewart at number five to keep wicket as well, what can you do to make sure that the plans next time are implemented?
Well, first of all, you've got to get runs on the board in test match cricket, and two totals of about 200 or just less than is obviously not adequate, and you're playing on a shoestring then. It's not really giving your bowlers enough runs to bowl at. So that's the first thing. And then the first thing is, bar the first hour, I thought we bowled okay, but we just gave them a kind of flying start of 70 or 80 and bowled with too much width.
Just talking about our batting again, the shot that seemed to cause most problems for England's batsmen was any variety of the cut shot. You can't really cut it out. What are the instructions for, say, the next five test matches?
Well, I think the intent's the right one. You've got to show a positive intent when you play against the West Indies. I'm never a believer in just waiting for the bad ball and playing that way, because I feel that's not the way to get runs against the West Indies. You've got to try and impose yourself and play aggressively. So the intent was the right one. I just think the execution was poor at times.
Raymond, a comprehensive defeat for England. Where do we go from here?
Well, we don't have a lot of options. We go back to the drawing board a little bit, that we can look around the country, but there are not a dozen players we can bring in. There are one or two options, no more than that. We've got to get the players that we have here playing better, and that's the object of the game then. We've got to get them playing better.
Yeah, one would hope that you wouldn't just fall into the trap of changing players around every time there's a defeat. Surely the continuity of selection is one of the things you're aiming for this summer.
Of course it is, if we can. We accept the fact that we are short in certain areas still. And until we get that right, we've got to go with the players we've got. We don't want to swatch and change about, because we think we've picked the best players at the moment. There may be just the odd bowler that could be different, but that's all.
Well, I think I got that right. One man very happy, that's Richie Richardson, and the skipper, Michael Atherton and Raymond Illingworth, adopting a very realistic attitude, but very, very unhappy at the end of this first test match. Geoffrey Boycott may be no happier, but he has his own ideas now on how the game went.
Well, the West Indies fast bowlers cleaned up England. Their batsmen were dismissive of the England bowling. They gave an exhilarating exhibition of stroke play. And so it looked like a comprehensive win for West Indies. I'm not so sure about that. I don't think there's too much to choose between the two teams. If England want to win the next test match, what they have to do is improve. That's obvious, because West Indies out-battered England and out-bowled them on this particular pitch. But really, it's about discipline for England if they're going to win at Lord's. I think they have to be disciplined in their bowling. They bowl far too short here, so they're going to have to pitch it up more. And their batsmen are going to have to be self-disciplined when it comes to playing sloppy shots. So better batting and better bowling for England, and you can beat West Indies.
Well, you only play as well as you're allowed at this level of cricket. And the West Indies didn't really let England get back into the game. They tried very hard to do so two or three times. Couldn't quite make it. The West Indies were too strong for them, and bear in mind that they were weakened with the loss of that bowler. Well, that's all from Headingley at test match level now. We go into the Benson Hedges semi-finals, and that game is at Worcester. It's Worcestershire against Lancashire. It's being played on Tuesday. Benson Hedges Cup semi-final highlights BBC Two at 8 p.m. And that's all we have from Headingley. The first test match of this series is gone. The West Indies triumphant. A great performance from them. And from Headingley, for the moment, it's goodbye.
night. We've